the chief medical officer would be identifying the persons who are already vaccinated so that we can get them on the ship. You see there's a ship in the harbor. Two of them there now. Good. And
the ships don't have enough personnel
at the moment to keep people on the ships. But they have enough personnel to transport persons to these destinations. But Simone Kiza Beach tells me that what she wants to do is to, the chief medical officer, is that those who are
vaccinated, she can get them going there
on the vessel, those on the ships, those who to go to particular destinations, if they choose to. This is a voluntary business.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
They would, those who are not yet vaccinated.
But who would be vaccinated? You would not want to send them immediately after vaccination. You would want to hold them, keep them for a day or two, because if some persons upon vaccination, you know, they develop an itch, a little wooziness in the head. You know how that is. Some people say you would like to keep them there, so there's 2 days and so on. So there are some matters which have to be dealt with.
And then the ships are doing, there are certain things we have to do with them. But I've spoken to one of the cruise lines leadership this morning, and you know, I must tell you, the way in which
people in St. Vincent and the Grenadines
and in ordinary people and in Grenada and in Dominica, St. Lucia and Antigua, have responded to put people in their homes, strangers, bring tears to my eyes. I love this Caribbean.
Your host, Captain. I don't know if I got that far. With your host, Nightwatch N8. Join me for another fascinating mental journey to the nether regions of what it means to be human. In this artificially real world. Does that sound cool enough? I hope so. In any case, thanks for watching. It's always a good time. Dead of winter. Snow's coming down again up here in the Rockies. High up in the Rocky Mountains. And meanwhile, the ash is falling on St. Vincent. La Safri, something like that, volcano. Solfri, I think it's French. Anyway, and I don't speak French, so I won't even try. Although I just did. So I want you to, try to put yourself in these people's shoes. Now, I'm very outspoken about my opinion of this whole pandemic narrative and the consequent problem, reaction, solution, cure, aka snake venom, that they're forcefully in some parts of the world, coming here soon, apparently, pushing on the world population right now. And so this story kind of grasped me, and I thought I'd explore it a little and share with you what I found. Because I don't know, I find this story fascinating in that it is kind of like a microcosm. It is the world in miniature, right? Now. And possibly in their not too distant future. It is like a little laboratory of how groups of people react under a stressful situation. It is a natural disaster. It is a pretty serious thing when you're living on a small volcano and it's about to explode. And so here you have this little psychological group experiment on a small portion of the Earth's population. And, you know, how will people react? How would you react? I've asked myself this several times now. So as stubborn as I am, as, you know, much as the issue is set in my own mind, whether or not I'm going to line up for the cattle inoculations. It's a hard sell. Imagine if you had the choice to stay on an island, stay home, which is happens to be a volcano, by the way. Possibly a poor choice, but a lot of those people didn't have that choice. And in a lot of respects, for the most, you know, most time out of the year, it's like paradise. And in fact, these people are, I know some people from the Caribbean, Dominican Republic, and they're some of the healthiest, God-fearing, A lot of them have very deep religious convictions. But, you know, they're out in the sunshine, they're eating fresh fruit constantly. They can grow amazing produce, veg, and that's my limited, I don't know what that, anyway, they are some of the, probably the most healthy specimens in the world, and we, meaning the Western interests, like the WHO and Mr. Gates, and all these other elitists that view the world's population as their livestock. You know, they're forcing their medicine on these people. And where is the, you won't hear from the WHO, you know, even though they're so concerned about civil liberties, whatever. I'm sure they've done plenty of griping about racism in America, but, you know, these people are being treated like they're, the cruise ships won't allow them on Unless they've been given the snake potion, right? So, many of these people, from what I read, is a population of about 100,000. Only 13,000 have been vaccinated. And from what we'll hear from another podcast, I kind of snuck away. I kind of snaked away. Interview with some of the locals, I guess there's a really substantial portion of the population on that particular island, which are very much opposed to this Western medical venom. So, it's a tough call, right? I mean, what would you do? What would I do? Man, that's got to be a tough decision. Are you willing to lay down your life for what you believe in? You know, a lot of these people believe in the Bible, believe in God, they're Christian. They believe that they were made in the image of God, and they are his dwelling place. And, you know, they don't trust Western medicine, right? Rightfully so. And so, man, I mean, how much history do you have to have as a lesson to fall back on, right? So, I'm gonna start right now. So I want you to just try to put yourself in these people's shoes and, you know, just kind of look at their faces, look at their expressions. Are those the faces of free men and women? Or do they not look more like scared, frightened, chased slaves? And I use that word intentionally, not because they're black people. I believe this is a global plantation, basically, at this point. The more you listen to these different puppet leaders from these different countries, they all sound the same, and they're all echoing the same talking points by the same multinational organizations, by these counterfeit global agencies that masquerade as a global government. So, you know, I've always thought it would be kind of nice, right, to live on an island. But then again, maybe not, because you are kind of trapped. You know, you're kind of landlocked on that little landmass. And so you are kind of subject to the laws of the land. You are subject to the higher authorities in as much as you can't really too easily run away. You know, you're surrounded by an ocean. You can't just jump in a car and take off to the next state or even cross the border into another country. So, in a sense, it is like a prison, right? Like how Australia started out. So if you haven't heard the history of the island, it's a long, sordid tale, and I won't take the time tonight to go over it all, but originally the people who inhabited the island came from South America, and then later the Carib people pretty much populated the island, and it was a mixture of escaped slaves from Africa. One story was there was a shipwreck, and some of the Africans were kind of assimilated into the That's one way to put it, I guess, into the Carib culture, and they became what later became known as Black Caribs. And, you know, and then it changed hands from French to British and, you know, became slave colonies where they grew sugar cane and cotton, I think, cocoa, coffee even. And, but there was this constant with the native Carib people. There were two wars fought with Britain, and they were pretty pretty hardy bunch, I guess you could say. They're pretty good warriors because they were able to fight off the British Empire on multiple occasions until eventually the partly due to the landscape, the mountainous landscape, but they eventually signed a peace treaty with Britain. And you know how it goes, just kind of eventually were absorbed into the British Commonwealth, and to this day are considered a kind of an oxymoron, a constitutional monarchy, I believe they call it. And of course they still have the Queen on their money. So yeah, and this story goes they were the last of the the Windward Islands, I think they're called, to gain independence, you know, whatever that means, but in 1979 it took them till they finally gained the title of independence, at least. So they were a pretty independent people, and they put up a good fight, and unfortunately they were just a little too far south of a free America, you could say, to escape the grasp of the crown, because, you know, to this day they're still part of the British Commonwealth, they call it. And along with the constant warring for their lands against European monarchs, there have been multiple natural disasters like hurricanes and, of course, volcano eruptions. Last major eruption was in 1902, I believe it was, and just completely devastated the island and much of the natural flora and fauna, as well as the native Carib communities that still resided there. So that little piece of real estate there out in the Caribbean Sea has it's been a hard-fought battle to keep the place occupied over all these years. And now, those people of recently liberated slaves are now facing a similar mindset where, you know, certain rulers take it upon themselves to treat the native people as cattle, to be put in the slave ships and sailed off to get their forced inoculations. Nothing new under the sun, right? Not too much has changed, unfortunately. Human nature hasn't changed much. And so, of course, this character in power who is directly responsible for implementing these WHO/UN mandates, such as forced inoculation of his population, Ralphie, let's just call him Ralphie. Prime Minister Ralphie, guess what? He's served since the nation declared itself independent way back in 1979. And of course, he also happens to be the richest man on the island, so go figure, right? Hence the appropriate caricature of Jabba the Hut. Because they're all puppets. They're all part of this big old happy umbrella, this big old happy family of the UN. United Nations, the WHO, Davos, the World Economic Forum, all of these different globalist groups that handpick these cute little sock puppet, make-believe, you know, I'll put on a little accent and try to sound like a Jamaican white guy leaders. And, you know, how much, you know, just think about it. Like, if you were Bill Gates, for instance, I'm just another random example. And you had hundreds of billions of dollars. Think of how many people in the world you could pay off, you could bribe, you could buy off. With business deals, you know, let's make it legal, right? In these third world nations, you know, how many slumlord, mob boss, wannabe rulers could you easily pay off to do your bidding, to follow your little sustainable development goals and, you know, mass inoculation programs. Ultimately, thinning the population.
This is the fast ferried first time docking here in Chateaubelair, the Jade and Sun. It's a bit more challenging for this vessel because it's not like the bigger vessels that will put the ramp on so that persons can drive on. In fact, motor vehicles are unable to board this vessel. But those with children, we're getting persons with children out. Those that are disabled and with children. You here with your parent, your mom, right? So, Lemon, you have children? You have a child with you? All right. We are allowing those. We have other boats coming, eh? So we are allowing those with children to come on for us. Let them board for us, all right? Captain of the Jade and Sun, Elvis, is doing a fantastic job. All the other captains and boat owners, I want to thank you for your response. You have been magnificent. We're doing quite well so far. You'll have the usual hiccups in the times of emergency, but this is understandable. I'm asking persons to be prepared to be vaccinated as well. Because once you leave Chateaubelair, you go to an evacuation center, you will also be vaccinated. This is not a drill and it is not voluntary. There's a pandemic that is taking place and we'll be vaccinating persons once they enter a government-operated shelter. And I want that to be very clear to persons as well for listening this live.
Nearly 20,000 people are out of their homes on the Caribbean island of Saint Vincent after the first volcanic eruption there in more than 40 years. The volcano sent a thick cloud of smoke 20,000 feet into the sky, spewing ash for miles. Cruise ships are evacuating people from the island, but only those vaccinated against COVID.
Report to control.
The percentage that's really misled by these conspiracy theories, it's unclear to me. There's millions of messages out there, you know, where my name or Dr. Fauci's name is used, but do people really believe that stuff? You know, we're gonna have to get educated about this over the next year and understand, you know, what, how does it change people's behavior? How should we have minimized this, either, you know, working with the social media companies or explaining what we were up to in a better way?
You know, the time for playing patty cake with these tyrants is over. Tag, you're it.